The Dolan Stratus are two judges that I have a huge amount of admiration for. They do amazing work for the Court of Appeal. It's especially a great privilege for me to be here so close in a context which can't possibly end with your appeal is dismissed with costs. It's happened once or twice. So I spoke with Justices Nadeau and Stratus about what aspects of their bios they both have, of course, extraordinary biographies, and I asked them what they would like me to emphasize. And you would think that most people would choose among their noblest accomplishments something that they're proud of. Instead, Justice Nadeau asked me to mention, perhaps he forgot where he was speaking, that he's a Detroit Red Wings fan. And that was bad enough.
Hey,
Justice Travis, drawn away from Leafs fan.
Go, Leafs, go. It's our only subject of disagreement.
True. You know, I know that every single person here is a hockey fans, just mentioned it. My drop names won the Stanley Cup 24 times. The Leafs, probably never in any of your lifetimes since 1967, only 13 times.
I saw them, but it was in black and white.
Right. I didn't even know television was invented when they last won the Stanley Cup. And Detroit has won more recently, we'll not mention it, but 11 times. So honestly, if you are in front of the Federal Court of Appeal with a bit of a loser case, you know that you have some justices that go for the underdogs. Aside from that, I did pull together some other legally relevant information about the judges who hear from you. I'll be brief. Justice Stratus obtained his law degree from Queen's University, and he studied at a law school called Oxford. And then he clerked for Justice Bertha Wilson in the Supreme Court. And during his lengthy career, he was considered one of Canada's top litigators. I think he was nominated one of the top litigators 8 years in a row, if I'm not mistaken. He was, like all great litigators, also a professor. And
the converse is not
And he taught at Queen's University for more than 8 years, where he still teaches a course, I understand, with Justice Cromwell on written advocacy. And he's written a number of articles on written advocacy, which students of mine will know, because I commended to you. Before he was appointed to the bench, he was named as a special advocate to represent people in national security cases. Again, students of mine will know that only among the very best litigators in Canada were selected for this responsibility to ensure that the program would comply with the constitutional requirements of Section 7. So it's an extraordinary honor, and it's a job that he was selected for just before he was appointed to the bench. In fact, I don't know if you've ever, did you ever act as a special advocate? Because you were appointed
some of a
couple of occasions. So he was appointed directly to the Federal Court of Appeal in 2009. When Canadian Lawyer named him one of the top 25 most influential jurists in Canada, they described him as the greatest administrative law jurist of our age. Any student of mine knows that I have often remarked that I could teach my entire class just on the basis of his judgments. Whenever some subject is unclear, they should go and look for one of his judgments, where it will likely be sorted out. Probably, in my mind, one of his most impressive pieces of academic writing is a recent piece called A Plea for Doctrinal Coherency and Consistency, which is largely the subject, I think, of what we'll talk about today. When this paper was published, while Justice Stratus was on the bench, in that day, I must have received 10 to 15 emails from people saying things like, wow, walk, don't run, don't walk, and read this paper. So it's enormously influential piece of writing. On a personal note, I have to say that Justice Stratus is being very generous with me personally. I'm very interested, as my students probably unfortunately hear too much, about the liability of the Crown and the relationship with judicial review. Most people did well on that question on the exam, citing Justice Stratus's decision in Parody Honey, which is, after it was published, produced a cottage industry of conferences on the subject in Canada, sparking a very vigorous debate on this subject.
I'd like to mention that I concur.
Justice Nadal did concur in his decision. Justice Kinsey wrote an interesting, but otherwise unremarkable, I concur.
He hasn't spoken once since then.
No. Le juge Nadal est un des nôtres. Il est né à Saint-Jérôme. Il a fait ses études de droit à l'Université de Sherbrooke. Il est expert en droit maritime et de droit de transport. Il a pratiqué plus que 20 ans à Montréal et à Londres, en Angleterre. Pendant plusieurs années, il aussi a enseigné le droit maritime à l'Université de Sherbrooke. Il a été nommé à la Cour fédérale en 1993. C'est la dernière année que les Canadiens ont gagné la Coupe Stanley, plus récemment que les Leafs de Toronto Maple Leafs. Mais ça fait longtemps quand même. En 1994, il a été nommé à la Cour martiale d'appel et le tribunal de concurrence en 1998 pour une période de 7 ans. Le 14 décembre 2001, il a été nommé à la Cour d'appel où il siège encore depuis 17 ans. Alors, si vous faisiez des calculs, il a été juge plus longtemps dans sa carrière qu'il a été avocat. C'est quand même assez impressionnant. When I was asked to introduce Justices Stratus and Nadon, I understand that they would be debating the subject because what you need is a debating society. And they quickly, on our first call, corrected me and said, there will be no debate. We largely agree on this subject. And I'll just say as my last remark that that's unsurprising to me because I don't think that there's any serious jurist in administrative law in Canada who is not dissatisfied with the decline of legal doctrine and the state and the incoherency of the jurisprudence on the subject. And perhaps the only judge I won't mention who thinks that is not here today. So maybe she'll come at some point. So without further ado, Justice Stratus, Justice Nadal.
Thank you, Professor. We were here, we came by car from Ottawa. We're prepared to travel some distance to participate in events organized by the Red Meat Society because we strongly believe in the goals that it's pursuing. So we're here. We're not going to charge anything before 7 o'clock. We'll be free till 7. But that's why we're here. We believe strongly in the values that were put forward by Mr. Zinni. We're going to try and make this interesting for you. As you said, David and I, we have these discussions, not every day, but often. So this is like a continuance of the discussions we have at night between them at 4:30, 5 o'clock. We discuss these things. But I think our theme is the abandonment of doctrine. I would add perhaps the abandonment of principle in judge making. And we're going to do it through, we're going to try and do it through a recent decision, Supreme Court, which Justice Francis will pass the baton shortly to him. But I, just to set the tone, I'd like to just cite something that was written by the latest appointment to the U.S. Supreme Court, Mr. Justice Gorsuch, on this theme, which I agree with. So speaking only for myself, I'm not going to read here, but I think it sets the tone of it for the discussion we'd like to have, where he said that he'd like to remind ourselves of the differences between judges and legislators, to remind us that legislators may appeal to their own moral convictions and to claims about social utility to reshape the law as they think it should be in the future. But that judges should do none of these things in a democratic society. That judges should instead strive, if humanly and so imperfectly, to apply the law as it is, focusing backward, not forward, and looking to text, structure, and history to decide what a reasonable reader at the time of the events in question. We were talking about the U.S. Constitution, so would have understood the law to be not to decide cases based on their own moral convictions or the policy consequences they believe might serve society best. And before passing the baton, I know that in many circles, perhaps in many law schools, that view of the law is unpopular. it seems to be considered an antiquated view of the law. I personally don't agree with that. But I think it's important that the matter be debated what actually judges should be doing, what courts should be doing. So, I pass it back to Martha.
Thank you very much, Justice Nadon. I'd like to thank you. Where are you, folks? There you are. Thank you for your really kind introduction. It's much appreciated. It's always a pleasure to be back at McGill. And it's an honor for both of us. To be here to help to advance the university's educational mission. Whether you agree with the messages we put forward tonight or not, it's our hope that this will stimulate thought and reflection about the nature of law, the role that law should play, and the future evolution of a very important area of that law, which is administrative law. Before continuing, I'd like to just publicly recognize an old friend, Professor Walters, who you heard I was at Queen's University. He was, too, before he came here, and you're so lucky to have him, one of Canada's top administrative law academics. It's always a pleasure to see you, Mark, and thank you for coming tonight. One thing we want to make clear is that although we're going to talk a bit to get things going, we really want it to be like a university seminar. Comment, challenge, cajole, express your views. There'll be plenty of opportunity to do that. We have a few things to say at the beginning, but once the discussion gets rolling, raise your hands and please participate. Now, Justice Nadon mentioned that we would begin with a case, just as a really the golf tee, so to speak, to put the golf ball on and drive it off to start this off. The case is Edmonton East, sometimes known as Capilano Mall, a decision of the Supreme Court of Canada in the last year. It really is, in our view, the last significant Supreme Court of Canada decision where the Supreme Court attempted to lay down a doctrinal basis for the review, substantive review, of administrative decisions in Canada. Just quickly, a show of hands, how many know about Edmonton East? Some, but far from all. I will begin with sort of a brief summary of the facts to explain how this tumbles down. And for those of you that have taken administrative law, we're talking the Dunsmuir Review, substantive review of administrative decisions by courts. The key issue in this area is how intensely should courts review administrative decisions? Should we defer, or should we review it on the basis of correctness and give no deference? On this subject, right now, the doctrine in the Supreme Court of Canada is kind of all over the place. There are clear majorities. Edmonton East was one, but only 5-4. And the complement of the court continues to change. So we're in an exciting period of uncertainty and transition. I've weighed in on those issues in the paper that Mr. Pless talked about, and others have too. It's a fascinating time to think about the doctrine. Like Justice Nadon, my view is that public law in general, and administrative law in particular, must be run by doctrine. I gave a speech once in January 2016, and it's on YouTube. If you put in my name, it will pop up quickly. And I made this argument. In public law erupts sometimes at very controversial times. Right now in Canada, we enjoy some peace, but it may not always be so. There may be civil insurrection, there may be war, there may be other natural disasters where government has to take extreme administrative action. And at the same time, the rights and civil liberties of Canadians may be very seriously impacted. My question for you is this, and I posed this in that 2016 speech. Some judge is going to have to decide a searingly controversial high-stakes matter, higher stakes than anything you know right now. Do you want that judge to decide on the basis of settled law and doctrine and fundamental principle worked out decades earlier? Or do you want the judge to rely on her or his personal views, ideological views, world views? Which scenario, A or B, is more likely to get the respect of a desperate populace struggling to handle a serious situation? In my view, it is doctrine that provides the foundation that allows judges in the future to make the tough decisions that will get respect. So like Justice Nadal, I feel the same way. Let me tell you a word or two about the case we're gonna tee off of. Edmonton East. Edmonton East, no prizes for guessing, started in Alberta. And it concerned a provincial municipal assessment board. There's several across Alberta. And it's basically a property tax issue in Alberta. And there's an Alberta statute, an assessment act, that sets out the ground rules for municipal taxation and the standards and the calculation of the tax and so on. So, in this case, a municipal assessment board was hearing an appeal from a taxpayer about its municipal taxes, and it was the mall. It was challenging its taxes. The administrator decided the issue. Of interest is that nobody before the board argued statutory interpretation. There was no dispute about what the Provincial Assessment Act said. The board came down with its decision. That was reviewed through the Alberta court system, and it arrives at the Supreme Court of Canada. Interestingly, in the Supreme Court of Canada, even though it had not been dealt with by the Administrative Tribunal, the key issue was the interpretation of the Assessment Act and whether the tax that was charged was legal and proper. The Supreme Court splits 5-4. The majority reaffirms older jurisprudence that says that in cases like this, cases where a tribunal interprets legislation, it is entitled to a presumption of reasonableness review, that is, a measure of deference to its statutory interpretations. Those of you that have done administrative law will know that was first set out in Dunsmuir. So the majority, 5-4, the majority of 5, basically reaffirms Dunsmuir on the presumption that tribunals that interpret their legislation are entitled to deference. What they do, though, is they really double down on the presumption, and they set out certain rationales supporting the presumption of deference. We can talk about those later, because that's where it gets interesting. The dissent, on the other hand, looks at the Provincial Assessment Act, finds little indications in it, like a full right of appeal, no privative clause, no clause saying the administrator's decision shall not be reviewed. Rather, what I used to call in practice a welcome mat. You may appeal decisions to a court. They look at that, they look at other types of indications in the statute. They look at the subject matter, assessment. You can't have different rates of tax and different manner of property tax applying in different places in a province under the same provincial statute. It should be common throughout. So the dissent says, 4 of them, it's correctness review. And we, the reviewing court, they say, can substitute our view of statutory interpretation for the administrative tribunal. In a nutshell, that's Edmonton East. And I turn it now over to my colleague for an evaluation of the decision.
I was going to add to what David said. The clause in the appeal clause in Brush said that the, an appeal could be taken before the Court of Queen's Bench, which is, I guess, the appropriate Superior Court in Alberta. So, as David said, there are no privative clauses. Parliament has not sent a signal or an indication that it was asking the courts to defer to the decision of the administrative tribunal. To the contrary, either the clause, and this is a clause which is often filed in many of the appeals we have, the legislature said, if you're not happy with the decision of the municipal assessor, or you may appeal on a question of law, I think it's there, you may appeal on a question of law to the Queen's Bench. We have many statutes where CRTC and things like that, where the clause says you may appeal on a question of law to the Federal Court of Appeal. So the question is, what does that mean? For the majority said, well, it doesn't really mean anything. Then we pass to the minority. The Alberta Court of Appeal took a long look at this, and a very learned judgment. I don't remember who wrote it. But in effect, said in 10 pages, this clause can only mean one thing. It can only mean that Parliament is saying, if you have a problem with a question of law, you go to the Queen's Bench and they will tell you what the answer is. So in some ways, it wasn't the only debate in the Supreme Court, but that was part of the debate. Because if you agree with that view, and I think the minority did, it means we will decide the question of law. We're not going to defer. We're not going to say, well, we don't agree with it, but we're going to defer because it's, well, we don't agree with it. That interpretation is reasonable. It's a very important question. And it poses the question of what are courts to do when Parliament sends a clear signal? And I say with respect, the signal could not be clearer. When Parliament says, you may appeal a question of law to the Court of Appeal, surely, if you've done Law 1, you'll understand that Parliament is not seeking the court to defer. Parliament is saying, go to the court and they'll tell you what it means. But that wasn't the result in that case. Actually, I think the majority, I say again with respect, and you can assume everything I say is with respect, the majority said in defiance, in my view, to Parliament, said, well, if the legislator is not happy, let them say expressly that it should be correctness. I say that can't be. That simply can't be. Unless the courts think Parliament doesn't have the right to dictate correctness, which it did in this case. The question that I think should be posed, and I've said this elsewhere, so that it hasn't gotten me into trouble, I didn't say it. I'm not sure David and I entirely agree with this, but it seems to me that what has happened, for those of you who study a bit, administrative law and standards of review, Supreme Court seems to be upset with the fact that Parliament is not willing to go along entirely with their view of that part of the law. In other words, you may remember, historically, the reason why we do have standards of review, the reason why we have deference to administrative tribunals, is because 50 years ago, probably even before we were born there, Parliament started putting clauses in statutes saying, courts, you're not going to interfere. We're giving the power to decide to this board, and you're not even going to be involved in this. You're not going to interfere at all. And courts reacted by saying, yes, but you can't exclude us totally. I think in those days they were called Oster clauses. I guess if I'm not pronouncing it well, O-U-S-T-E-R. And courts started saying, when I was in law school, we learned on standard of review that there were two subjects in regards to which courts could intervene: errors of jurisdiction and what was called errors on the face of the record. I don't think we knew, actually. I think we went through law school, we didn't know exactly what an error on the face of the record. I think I now know that it's something that jumps in your face. But that was developed because Parliament was trying to exclude to the law courts from review. But now we're in a world where, even though Parliament does not exclude the courts from judicial review, The courts are excluding themselves. So I have difficulty with that proposition, where we're prepared to exclude ourselves from the decision-making process of determining what legal questions, what the answer to legal questions are, when Parliament has invited us, in my view, to decide these cases. So that, in my view, is a very troublesome aspect of that decision. And actually, it troubled the Alberta Court of Appeal. And I understand that the Alberta Court has rendered another decision now in reaction to that, because they surely don't think that the majority was right. But I think they were wrong, clearly wrong. But as we all know, as lawyers and future lawyers, whether we agree or not doesn't matter. If the Supreme Court says the law is the law, we have to follow it. But there are many people, I think, in the legal community who think that that approach is wrong. We spend enormous time debating standards of review ad nauseam, to the detriment, I think, of substance. But the only reason in my view this has happened is that the principle has been thrown over the wayside. For some reason, a game, not a game of chess, this is what I was going to say earlier, a new game has been created that's called the game of the standard of review. It's like the Monopoly game. There seems to be a patent. The Supreme Court controls the game, and even Parliament is not allowed to intrude in this game unless we say so. So it's very disturbing. For those of you who haven't got into this here, in this area, though, when you do, try and take a look at these clauses and just it's, and ask your professors why is it that the courts will not follow what Parliament has said, unless we think the courts have the right to overrule Parliament. They do in the case of the Charter, but otherwise they don't.
I have points of agreement and disagreement with my colleague. Let me start with the points of agreement and going back to Edmonton East. First of all, one thing my colleague said is absolutely right. It was a 5-4 majority that says that the presumption of deference to tribunal interpretation of statutes applies. In court, if you come to any court I'm in anyway, and you try and suggest otherwise, I have to shake my head and say the Supreme Court says presumption of reasonableness applies. But the law is in flux and it may change. So let me go back to Edmonton East and what they say about the presumption of reasonableness. Justice Karakatsanis, writing for the majority of five, I'll give this compliment. Gamely, she tries to explain the policy rationales why the presumption of deference to all tribunal decisions concerning the interpretation of statutes is a good thing. And I compliment her for that, but in the end, I find the policy justifications really wanting. First, she says, and my friend here touched on this, she says, if Parliament doesn't like this judicially constructed presumption, it can pass legislation being clear. So for instance, in Alberta, the onus would be on the Alberta legislature to say, in the Assessment Act, decisions shall be reviewed on the basis of correctness. I think this has it backwards. Let's start from first principles of public law. The highest principle, subject to constitutional objection, it's an important qualifier, subject to constitutional qualification, the law on the books passed by the legislatures and Parliament is binding on everybody, judges included. And so if Parliament or legislatures, through proper interpretation of statutes that set up administrative tribunals and give them powers, if it's clear that they intend full review by courts with their deference, we are bound by that. And judicially constructed presumptions have no place. In a way, what the Supreme Court has done is it's created a negative optioning scheme where the judicially created presumption of deference is the default. And if Parliament doesn't like it, the onus is on them to oust it. That has it backwards. The role of the court is to interpret Parliament's law that binds all. That's the starting place. The second point she makes to defend the presumption is she says, The presumption of deference to tribunal decisions promotes access to justice. And she doesn't really explain why. And in the end, personally, I think that policy is wanting as a justification. I think more correctness review, where courts actually settle interpretations, reduces people going to administrative tribunals by replacing uncertain interpretations by tribunals that may pass muster under reasonableness review. Replace it with correctness review, and the public and the government and the board, they all know what the law is. So correctness review, I think, can promote access to justice by settling the law. So I find that justification wanting. Lastly, Justice Caracasana suggests a different approach, a so-called contextual approach, where we look at various indicators like parliamentary intention, how parliament has set up the tribunal, the mandate it's given, whether it's an adjudicative mandate or a policy mandate. She suggests that promotes uncertainty, that contextual approaches are uncertain and you'd have to litigate a lot. And as we know from the Heriniak decision, an excellent decision by, again, Justice Caracasanas, if we can reduce litigation and associated expense, that's a good thing. So far, so good for that rationale, except that I say this. Contextual approaches where we look at factors and decide about the intensity of review. Where else have we done that in our law? Baker and Minister of Employment and Immigration. On procedural fairness, we evaluate the level of procedural fairness and whether the tribunal has met it with a fivefold contextual approach. You can see that, I think, paragraphs 21 to 26 of the decision. Since Baker was decided in 1996, there hasn't been a lot of litigation on procedural fairness. Oh, it happens, but it's not like the Supreme Court of Canada is reinventing the law every 5 years. Baker, a decision of 22 years, remains the seminal decision on point, unmodified. So contextual approaches don't always cause litigation, they can reduce litigation. Like my colleague, fundamentally, I start with that organizing principle of law, that Parliament is supreme, and that the law in the books binds us all. And so our task in judicial review should be to try to ascertain what the legislature intended when it set up the tribunal, and what level of interference it wishes reviewing courts to engage in. I just want to say one more thing, and I'm sorry for taking so long, but this tees up many of our issues. The existing approach of the Supreme Court of Canada in Dunsmuir, Edmonton East, and all the associated cases, where we review the substance of administrators' decisions. So far, the methodology is first, decide whether the standard review is correctness or reasonableness, and then apply the standard. Sounds easy. But what the Supreme Court has done is it expends, in some cases, a lot of energy trying to decide whether it's correctness or reasonableness. It concludes it's reasonableness, but all too often it does correctness. So especially on statutory interpretation, the way it does reasonableness is it comes up with its own interpretation of the statute and then measures its own interpretation like a yardstick against what the tribunal has done. That is correctness review. What I say is ditch the categories, correctness and reasonableness. What we're talking about is the intensity of review. How fussy should the courts be? Insist on correctness, give a little leeway, give moderate leeway, give a heck of a lot of leeway. It all depends, and it depends fundamentally on two things. Parliamentary intention, which I mentioned, but also the principle of the rule of law. Even under a deferential standard, sometimes a decision is so antithetical to rule of law values, rules of civilized decision making, that we must interfere. That's kind of the scheme as I see it. Why does standard of review matter? That's the point where I disagree with you. It's true it's become a cottage industry. But you know what standard of review is how fussy should the judiciary be with the executive branch and its decisions? That's pretty fundamental. You got three tectonic plates: the judiciary, the executive, and parliament. Standard of review deals with these two tectonic plates. Every case is a little earthquake. And what the court has to do is define with more precision and more coherence and consistency when it will interfere with the executive branch. Something trivial that we spend too much time on? That's only because it's not being done right. It's absolutely fundamental. We need to define it. We need to stick to it for all time.
My friend and I always say, my views on correctness should prevail most of the time, unless there's no other way. My friend Justice Stratton says he disagrees. He disagrees on principle, but in practice he agrees, because he finds that really, for all intents and purposes, there's only one real interpretation possible. So if there's only one reasonable interpretation possible, it almost comes down to correctness. But let me say why I'm a stickler for correctness. I think it has to be said. What we're dealing with is an administrative tribunal interpreting its own statute. So if it's the CRTC, it's interpreting a very important and complicated statute. The Transport Agency Canada is the same thing. It's interpreting a very complicated statute. It doesn't matter, simply legal drafting. These are typical. Now, I'm prepared to say, and I'm not ashamed of saying it, that the experts in statutory interpretation in Canada are the judges, not administrative board members, many of whom are not all that good at law. I think some decisions have to be said. But so we're saying that this group of administrative decision makers, when they interpret provisions of their home statute, quote unquote, they have to be given deference. We're not talking about legal, we're not talking about factual questions, we're talking about interpretation of legal questions. So that's what we're talking about. Remember, when we hear appeals from the federal court, the tax court, on legal questions, they are interpreting their own statutes. We don't give a toss about their expertise. They're either right or wrong. Now, let me say why I think correctness is important. First of all, standards other than correctness have a tendency to make some judges lazy. If it's correctness, you have to say why. You have to say why you're in disagreement. You have to explain it. Often, if you read decisions, I'm not imputing any bad faith of our judges, but human nature is human nature. It's much easier to look at a complicated decision from a board member or a court, review it, and say the court or the board decided this and this and that. While I might not agree, this is the standard, I might not agree, it's not unreasonable. Bingo, you've done your job. I don't like that. I don't. The judges, particularly on the level of courts, judges should say why they think the interpretation is wrong and explain it. It serves many purposes. The litigants know why, and if it goes to Supreme Court, the Supreme Court will have another draft to work. In the current state of affairs, often important questions of law are going to go to Supreme Court, where the Court of Appeal has not really said anything other than the administrative board or the judge, they've applied the right standard. They've identified the right standard and they've applied it correctly. Don't have to go into a long-winded explanation about the law. So this has the effect, in my respectful view, of, in many instances, and particularly so when the Supreme Court looks at a case and says, well, the interpretation is unreasonable. And they say it's unreasonable because of the following reasons. And then they basically, yes, I think David, they then give a legal explanation as to why the interpretation adopted by the board is wrong. A sort of, we're not saying, but it's really correct. And you could kid yourself, we can say it's reasonable, but in reality, we're driving to a certain result.
It's correct.
There are many decisions of the Supreme Court which you can't really justify on the grounds of reasonableness, but they're really correctness under this guy's act. But one of the, as I said, sad effects is, in many instances, the discussion of the legal question, which should appear on the Court of Appeal decision to enlighten the Supreme Court one way or the other, does not appear. And that, to me, is not good. I just wanted to make a comment on who is to decide whether there should be or more litigation before the courts and the Supreme Court? Certainly not the courts. It's up to Parliament to decide if we want to open the door or not. The courts are not there to say, well, we have enough cases and don't bother us. And you see a comment in SADVA by the Supreme Court, where I think our mutual friend, Mr. Justice Rothstein, wrote it, where we are now told that after 50 years of being wrong now, matters of contractual interpretation are not pure questions of law. They're like mixed facts of law. So therefore, we can be deferential now. Suddenly, we're not going to say the judge erred in interpreting. Well, I don't know. It's one possibility. But somewhere in the judgment, Mr. Justice Rothstein, I don't remember his exact words, but he says something like, also, we think this type of question shouldn't be bothering us in the Supreme Court. No, this private matters between private litigants. I find that a pretty dangerous proposition from the Supreme Court to say, we don't really want private litigants to come and argue matters of contractual. We have bigger and better things. As I say, if Parliament wants to make it so Parliament can, some of the courts do this. So there are many problems, but I think correctness, it should be on matters of law. One last point, because I think this is important. When you've all read statutes enacted by the Parliament of Canada or enacted by the province of Quebec, has anyone ever seen a statute with an appendix at the end which says, with regard to section 7 of this act, there are three possible answers? I don't think you'll find that. But apparently now, under this presumption of reasonableness, somehow there are two, maybe three possible interpretations. Now, they're not, I think, as Justice Rand says, I agree that most of the time you can say there's only one. But theoretically, what it means is this. You come before us one day, you go before a board, and the board said, our view of the statute is this, you lose. Your brother appears before the same board with different panel members on the same point, and the other board says, no, we think you're right, you win. That's what it means. You may have two different interpretations. I guess theoretically they're both reasonable. But in my experience of 45 years in the law, as I say, when Parliament enacts legislation, as complicated as it may be, as difficult to understand indeed as it may be, Parliament only intended one meaning to this. No one in Parliament has ever said there may be maybe two or three meanings. We'll let the courts figure out which meaning they got. It doesn't work that way. So to go to a world where more and more we're leaning and say, well, interpretation is reasonableness and so on, I think it's a very dangerous proposition. I don't like it. That's why I'm getting close to retirement. I don't have to. I
hope not for long.
By the way, I wouldn't let this pass. Professor Best was ready. Everywhere I go when I'm introduced, I usually say after the introduction, you forgot to say that I was appointed to Supreme Court. presenters are always, I'm not sure if they may want not to hurt my feelings, but I was, and at a certain view of the world, some say I've never been revoked, I'm illegally a court of appeal.
Those of you who interview with him in the clerkships, which is due tomorrow, I should mention, your application. If you interview with Justice Meadow, you will see his letters patent on his wall. It's a very interesting thing. Let me carve out. I would say, my friend, that you've over-argued the point, not by much, but let me carve out one place where reasonableness should apply in the area of statutory interpretation. And let me illustrate, and where I get to in the end, to tell you where I get to in the end, is under this scheme, it will depend on parliamentary intention,
But obviously, the implication is there will be much more correctness review of tribunal interpretations of their home statutes under the scheme that I think doctrinally must apply. Let me illustrate my point by giving you this example. Imagine a pet licensing board, and under its statute, here's the provision. In the case of dogs, licenses shall be issued on Wednesday. I think there's one reasonable interpretation of that. I mean, maybe if I have too much to drink, I could cogitate things like someone's in Japan and they're the next day and they, you know, the conflicts of laws problem, sort of an intricate type of problem that Professor Walters sets on his exams. I mean, you can imagine a situation where, you know, you could create an interesting interpretive issue, but come on, get real. Wednesday is Wednesday is Wednesday. And it's not right to think there's a range of meanings. Let me change the provision. In the case of dogs, the board shall issue licenses when reasonable. Far-fetched? Last time I checked, in the public interest and when reasonable, that statutory standard, Canley tells me, applies 2,200 times in federal regulations and statutes. It's quite common. Now, what does a court know about when it's reasonable to issue a dog license? Suppose you're dealing with a board that deals with 250,000 pets a year. Someone walks in with a coyote dog. That's what they call it, a coyote dog. Is it a dog? And is it reasonable that it not have a license? Person says, I don't need a license. This is a specialized board. From its statute, you may see that there's a veterinarian on the board, there's animal behavior experts and the like. Aren't they better empowered to decide what's reasonable than a bunch of judges who have done nothing but law all their lives? This, I think, is an area where, going back to the legislative intent, which must be our starting point, absent constitutional concern, didn't the legislature intend that these folks kind of flesh out the meaning of what's reasonable? In other words, hasn't implicitly the legislature delegated the interpretive responsibility to the tribunal and recognized that a bunch of old lawyers like us don't know anything about coyote dogs and whether they should be licensed and what's reasonable?
I'm happy to say to Justice Stratus on the standard here that I entirely agree.
Yeah, you see, this is what happens. We have these endless debates, and then at the end of the evening, we find out. So I think there is a place for deference, but a presumption of deference across the board makes no sense. Hey, should we entertain some questions?
Sure.
We've been traveling along.
Let me say, sometimes, you know, we all have our frustrations, and I have to, you know, disclose a decision I wrote years ago regarding the pipeline tribunal. Smith versus the pipeline tribunal.
Yeah.
5 years ago, is the decision which I wrote for our court, interpreting a provision of the, I won't bore you, the pipeline regulation and so on, which was there to settle differences between owners of land on which pipelines were passed, and it created a lot of difficulty and frustration between the owners. And there was an issue as to cost. We, looking at the provisions, decided what it meant. That cost meant the cost incurred within the context of this regulation of the Act. Not cost incurred by the parties in separate litigations before the Superior Court of the Province. It went to Supreme Court, we were reversed, and Mr. Justice Fish wrote it, and that is where they, I think, initially, the first time, said there's a presumption of reasonableness applying to decisions. So I disclosed that I wasn't happy to be reversed. So there you go. So that's not because I'm upset that I take this view.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, you can read Smith versus Pipeline, Alliance Pipeline. You can send me an email saying what you meant. So we're. We're ready and eager to have questions if you have any. And don't be, we'll answer about anything subject to propriety.
Not just on what we talked about, but anything within the ambit perhaps of administrative law and courts and legislatures. And don't be shy. Yes.
Well, I guess you've spoken a lot about the standards of review, but I'm wondering if you could speak more about what doctrine means to you and what are the stakes there?
I can begin to
talk about it. You wrote the article.
There are certain aspects of our law that should not be in serious dispute. They are accepted, time-honored principles from which we can deduce the legal rules that ought to apply to certain circumstances. Let's talk about parliamentary supremacy. Parliamentary supremacy was won at great cost centuries ago, culminating in the Glorious Revolution, so-called, in the United Kingdom in 1688. Much blood was spilled. And leading up to that, centuries of fights between royal authority and parliament, with parliament by and large winning out. An expert on this is Professor Walters here, much more learned than I could ever possibly be. Professor Walters has tremendous scholarship on the common law of the Constitution. And that's kind of where we're operating at the present time. This principle that a democratically elected legislature that passes laws has the right to do so, and it binds everyone according to the terms of the law, even the judges who apply it and interpret it neutrally. That's a fundamental principle. That's doctrine. That's not up for grabs. That's about as basic to our legal system as the fact we're carbon-based life forms is basic to humans. Star Trek doesn't apply, no silicon, no Vorta. Okay? It's a fundamental assumption of our system. There is another competing principle, and that's the constitutional principle of the rule of law. The rule of law can mean many things. The Supreme Court has defined it, I think, well, in a case called Imperial Tobacco in 2005. In the context of administrative law, I think it demonstrates and illustrates certain good administrative law values that decision makers at the administrative level should follow. One academic, Paul Daly, at Cambridge University, the author of the fantastic blog, Administrative Law Matters, has written an article on administrative law values. Many of the values he identifies are aspects of the rule of law. Am I making this up? No. In Dunsmuir, foundational case of Dunsmuir, paragraphs 21 through 25, I think, in Dunsmuir, talks about these two principles as animating principles behind judicial review. The legislature has delegated to tribunals the task of deciding things, and sometimes says, courts stay out, there shall be no review. At the same time, we have this principle of the rule of law. It's a constitutional principle. It's in the preamble to the charter. Notwithstanding that parliamentary delegation, if the tribunal does certain things, we must interfere as courts. From these two principles, somewhat vague, all the doctrine should follow. And so if you're following me so far, this is why the presumption, judicially constructed presumption of deference, sits very uneasily. That emanates from courts and is dictated to parliament. Rather, we should start, as Dunsmuir did, from these two principles and deduce downward. And so my article in the Social Science Research Network, the one that Mr. Pless mentioned, a plea for doctrinal coherence and consistency, that's its methodology. It starts with those two principles. And the whole paper, 27 pages in length, is nothing more than a logical deduction guided by some previous case law on how those principles should play out. Does that help to define? Yeah. And of course, the more we flesh out those principles and settle them, they too enter doctrine.
And so that horrible day 25 years from now, when some judge is going to make a fearsomely controversial high-stakes decision, and there's protests in the streets and violence, if that judge relies on multi-decade, logically produced, coherent, consistent law, the decision is more likely to be respected than someone who just says, well, in my view, in these circumstances, the justice of the thing supports that the applicant should win. That is an individual judge's view grounded on nothing.
I think it's not controversial to say that when we were appointed judges, that we were not said the justice granted, you now can decide cases based on your sense of fairness or justice.
You don't want that.
Although there are judges who say these things. I would only add as a comment to what David said. The principle doctrine is everything. Judges abandoned principle, abandoned doctrine, were in for very difficult times in the future, or it may well. And I said in other venues, so I apologize to those who have heard me before, and this doesn't call for an answer. When you read a decision of a court, and I guess particularly the Supreme Court, because it's the most important event, and you read a decision, why do you like it? Ask yourself, why do I like this decision? Do you like it because you like the last sentence? Do you like the result? Or do you like it because it's based on precedent, based on doctrine, based, this is the right result? I tend to think that some of you are honest, might say, well, I like it because I like the result. Well, that's very dangerous, because that's assuming that you're always going to get the result that you like. It may come a time where you may not like the result. And then you might say, well, what about principle? Well, the other thing I would say on that, where I think to me is an indication of principle has gone by the wayside, we get many decisions where the Supreme Court in effect overturns itself on what I would call very flimsy ground. I made a study which I presented elsewhere. I've taken like 5, 6, 7 decisions where the Supreme Court has reversed itself. It's someone, Carter, Burns, Dunsmuir is a good example, is another one. And I said, what's the common thread? How can you explain that this decision has reversed the case rendered like 5, 6, 7, 8 years ago? The common denominator, the only one that I found, is the judges on the most recent case were not the same as the one 5 years ago. You get a changing of the guard, and because we're on administrative law, let me take Dunsmuir, let's take 30 seconds. 2 years before Dunsmuir was decided, there were two decisions that appeared before the Supreme Court on the same issue. Essentially same thing. An attempt to go from the three-pronged approach of reasonableness, patentable reasonableness, correctness, to something simpler, reasonableness and correctness. In those two cases, Mr. Justice Lavelle attempted to do what he succeeded in doing in Dunster, and he lost 7-2. 2 years before, we're not talking 10, 20 years, 2 years. So suddenly, Dunsmuir appears within a couple of years, and suddenly, it's 9-0. They just decided twice within the 2 years. What's the... Well, the answer is, in my small case, I'm not finding justice granted, it's because justice's major Yakubovich had left the court. That's the real answer. But as a matter of doctrine and principle, in my respect, it's not acceptable. They decided clearly. The system was working well, speaking for myself. The old system was working well. This system has not, in my respect, has not improved anything. We've had to restart doing things which we have decided in the past. But I'm saying if doctrine, whether it's better or not is an entirely different thing, but surely it can't be that we, the 9 of us or the 5 of us or the people, we think this is going to be better, and therefore we're going to, well, what prevents anyone next year from doing just the opposite?
And that's been the pattern. I called Canadian administrative law the never-ending construction site, where roughly every 10 years there's a new scheme or a new system. And the only thing that's changed is the composition of the bench. This has to stop. It's drawing a very important field into disrepute. We need doctrinal stability. Again, for that day in the future, when a controversial decision may have to be made, and some unfortunate judge somewhere is going to have to rely
on principles that I hope are bedrock principles.
Because it's sauce for the goose, it's sauce for the gander.
Oh.
As they say, and I know I'm gonna say it anyway. As you, those of you who follow what happened in the United States, for a long time, the U.S. Supreme Court has had, until the death of Mr. Justice Scalia, four conservative judges, four liberal judges, and one libertarian, Mr. Justice Kennedy, who has wound up being the decider. He's decided one or the other. Justice Scalia has died. He's been replaced by Mr. Justice Gorsuch. It could well be within the next 2 years that if Madame Justice Ginsburg goes, maybe, or Justice Kennedy, there may be another appointment who may be conservative. And the conservative judges might find themselves with the majority. It may well be on certain matters that are of importance to you and others in society, the decision might not go the way you would expect it to go, because you now have judges who have a very different view of the world. But if they decide on principle and doctrine, they're not going to be, or they should be, setting aside every single decision. If they decide on their sense of what's right or wrong, some people might not like, I'm not saying this is going to happen, but that's why precedent, because it seems to me that, I'm not more well known than Justice Stratus, I'm more notorious because you've seen my picture in the paper. Even yesterday, they had one picture that they keep showing. Thank God it's okay. It's the institution. We're talking about courts are institutions. You're not free to go there and say, well, I'm going to change the world. The law is the law. The law is not just set for you. You have to apply the rules. I'm fearful sometimes that we're progressing, going away from that. And as I'll repeat it, when I hear judges saying, well, I decide cases based on what I think is fair, that's not my view of judge making. And I say that sounds to me arbitrary. Remember the statue of justice, the balance, which you see, she's blind. And why is she blind? Because she's going to render justice the same to everyone on the same facts and on the law. She's not there to choose. And that's very important. The law's not there to choose winners and losers. The law is the law. And that's a view of the law.
Comments? Yes, sir.
So a brief question. Why is it that in the States there's such a big politicization of the Supreme Court along party lines, whereas in Canada, at least in my view, it seems to be less?
That's
a softball for you.
You'll say we did not plan the question.
Okay.
I can answer. I recently said to judge of the Canadian Supreme Court, who I like very much, I said, I don't want to offend you, but I have more respect in many ways for the American Supreme Court than yours. His gut answer was, U.S. Supreme Court is political. He didn't say ours isn't, he said U.S. So my answer was, and will be to you, listen, Section 7, Section 15, the Due Process Clause, it's all about politics. It depends on your view of the world, how you view the world, how you view equality. The Americans have, contrary to us, they have now four judges who have a more conservative view, I would say, and I'd say I'm not ashamed of it, similar to mine. They have a different view of the world than the other four. Right here on it. They have a different view. So therefore, when you get a judgment on, for example, if you read the, I can never pronounce it, Obradorsko, the same-sex case in the Supreme Court, you have five in the majority in favor, four in the minority, with three dissents. And if you read them, they're all pretty convincing, depending on your view of society. In Canada, the difference, this is the difference. Instead of having four conservatives and four liberals, you have nine liberals. So in that sense, in that sense, it's not political, but we all agree. If we all agree, it's not political. But come on, even there's a professor at Oxford, I don't remember his name, Michael, he wrote a book years ago.
Mandel.
The whole theme of his book is what he calls, I think, the political. He and I probably we would not agree on much, probably, if we discuss politics at all. But I agree with the central theme of his book. He says we politicize the law. That's what we do. So why does it matter in the states whether Mr. Justice A or B is on court or here? But here we don't have the same debate. It's done in a different way. But it matters because depending on their view of the world, they're going to decide issues under Section 7 differently. It's not because they're smarter or more dumb. It's because they have a different view of the world. So to answer you, our court is as political as the American. They play politics, but they all agree. So there's no debate that's there. We occasionally do, but it's really mild mannered debate. When I say there are no conservatives, I should perhaps withdraw. There may be one or two now. Time will tell. But the conservative appointments of Mr. Stephen Harper were not conservative.
I agree to this extent. There's a remarkable uniformity of view on many issues where you would expect vigorous debate. So on assisted suicide, unanimous decision of the court. On the constitutionality of prohibitions against hate speech, a unanimous decision of the court, just to name two. Where, the Senate is another. I mean, there are many very controversial cases where there are respectable legal positions on either side of the debate, but there's a remarkable consensus that takes place.
It's an interesting phenomenon. Where could you find 9 people in Canada who would agree on defending? I say you would have great difficulty finding 9 times.
There's something a bit paradoxical in that, because if you believe on the one hand that doctrine save the rule of law because it's clear and the judge is deciding based on the doctrine, not on their own views, then it shouldn't really matter what the judge's politics are. My question is, that's just a reaction to the way the debate has gone, but I come mainly from private law, and I've often noted how frequently our court disregards what it said often very recently without necessarily even commenting on it, which I find troubling because I do doctrinal work. And what I think, this is really important, what you have to say on this, because what I think, because doctrine, at the same time as it's important and we need it and so on, it must evolve sometimes. We can't have the same doctrine as we did 700 years ago. And so what I think is missing from our court, and in my view, even more so from the U.S. Supreme Court, is a theory of when it is acceptable for the court to overrule itself. Because it must be sometimes, but it can't be done all the time. And I have read a few cases of our court talking about when it can overrule itself, none of which, in my view, are satisfactory, and some of which are inconsistent with one another. So it's the same problem repeated at the meta level. So I'd be interested to
I truly believe in precedent and doctrine, and I'll give you an example which goes against me. Had I been on the Supreme Court, one of my fondest dreams would have been, at least in theory, is to overturn the BC Motor Vehicle Act. And for those of you who know what that is, it means the Supreme Court can't second-guess the government on Section 7. I think that decision was erroneous in law. It disregarded the clear intention of our founding fathers as to what the words principles of fundamental law meant. I don't think there's any doubt. And you can realize the consequences of overturning BC Motor Group. It would clear the docket in the Supreme Court. It would make litigation. They'd have to find other cases. Whether, if I were sitting there, I would be prepared to overturn it, maybe not, because it's been there for a long time. The law has been settled. There's a precedent which you can say the same thing about Roe versus Wade in the state. Chief Justice Rehnquist had said that he would overturn Roe versus Wade. And when the time came where I think he could have had a majority, he decided not to because of the it's been there for 20 years, the profound legal consequences, so he did not do so. But as I say, the charter is a particular animal. You know, we've been discussing statutes. So the charter, as I say, and I don't withdraw any word, part of the effort and the work of judges on the charter is a political act. Those who pretend otherwise, well, I respect your opinion, but I disagree. These are political questions, couched in legal language. So they're in a way in a separate category. That's why they need for such a major debate in the United States, even a presidential election, because everyone understands that, depending how the judges view, because if it was all a matter of being appointing the best judges in the world, the best legal minds, it wouldn't be an issue. But it goes without saying, I think there are probably 500 judges in Canada who could sit on the Supreme Court, but the government might not want all of them unless they know what they are. How they think, how they view the world. You know, if a judge thought that women were inferior to men, I don't think the liberal government would appoint that judge. Rightly so. But it's a general proposition. I think in matters of administrative law, civil law, surely doctrine and principle are absolutely good. There may be cases where, you know, in common law they would reverse precedent because the times have changed, etc. Well, the court says we made very dramatic mistakes of law, so it can be. But I think it's very dangerous for the courts to abandon precedent unless there's not a bloody good reason to do so. Right? So
a couple reactions. First of all, although the foundational principles for judicial review can be simply stated, how they play out in particular cases is a question of debate. And in our legal system, the way these questions are resolved, as we all know, is good common law method, where judges forge chains in a link of jurisprudence, and each additional chain builds on the last. And over time, more clarity emerges. Think of everything that's happened since Donahue and Stevenson in the law of negligence. It's played itself out largely in accordance with precedent to the point where today, some 9 decades after Donahue and Stevenson, we have a clearer view of negligence. That's how it should play out. And the same should happen in public law. As for obeying precedent, I too regret the lack of adherence to precedent and the disregard of earlier authority in some cases, including their very own authority on respecting precedent. In 1991, there was, in my view, a fantastic foundational Supreme Court case called Crown and Solitaire, and it was written by Justice Sapinka. And it set out the guidelines under which the court will overrule one of its early precedents. I don't think Solitaire has been cited for a decade. But if you go back and read in 1991, it's very sage. It mixes the need for respect for old precedent with the need for the evolution of the common law. As I said in the decision you mentioned, Parody Honey, you know, the Constitution may be sometimes a living tree, but private law is no petrified forest. It too must grow and adapt, but it needs to do so through respect for the earlier precedent and incremental, sensible tweaking and change to that precedent. Respect for precedent is not the same as conservatism, far from it. Some of us rely on rules of precedent and are quite innovative when the situation calls for it. That's kind of my response. I don't know if that fully answers your question. It's regrettable that the precedent is not respected.
You're right in your criticism because, for example, I'm not a criminal lawyer, but there's a case out there called R versus Burns, which had to do with extradition of people who committed crimes in the United States subject to the death penalty. And the issue was whether should Canada extradite them. In previous case, R versus Crindler, the court said 5-4, by extraditing these people who would be subject to the death penalty, in that case, it was in California,
There, Canada is not infringing your rights under Section 7 because you'll have a trial, they'll have a lawyer, they'll have a judge, they'll have a jury, etc. That was Crinver. In Burns, it was the same thing, different people, state of Michigan. The court came to a result that Canada had to, before extraditing, Canada had to ask the state of Michigan to undertake not to impose a death penalty on the person. And that, so they reversed Crinver. But the irony is, they never said so in their decision. It was Mr. Justice Binney a year or two after in a speech to a gathering. You know, he said, by the way, in our versus Burns, we overturned Crinver. They never said so.
It's wrong. Okay. There are many examples.
It's a bit wrong.
Anyway, I saw a hand at the back. Do you have a question?
It was concerning the sentence. Okay.
Concerning?
The sentence.
Oh, the sentence.
You had commented that there was in response to my colleague's comments, the fact that there is something nice about a uniform decision by the Supreme Court provided for certainty, and yet working in constitutional law, the lack of dissent is saddening because some of the most people that are
comparative
to a
percent of
Martin
Collar. Right.
It has had an impact.
Justice
on
Wilson.
Pardon?
Yeah. Justice Wilson.
Sorry, Justice Wilson, yeah. It's had an impact so much on the way we see the right of liberty. But that was her alone speaking on that in that way. And it's sad that we don't have that.
I admire
she just welcome for unifying court. I don't think it has to do just with politics.
You know, another great example is Justice Lurie DeBay, and maybe that's why you confused her name. I believe it was in O'Karn, where she dissented and set out her view of rape shield laws,
yes,
and their acceptability. And she convinced Parliament in the dissent. So Parliament enacted a new law. Dissents are vitally important. They can play a huge role in the evolution of judicial law, but more importantly, legislative law. And I think the rape shield laws in Canada are a good example.
I was just curious about whether the area of administrative law is predisposed to doctrinal uncertainty, and if that's the case, why that may be, or maybe it's not.
Well, I think not, and let me make that case. And admittedly, your point is not without merit. Lots of people hold that view. Recently, at a conference in Cambridge in 2016. Conference I attended, Chief Justice Elias of the New Zealand Supreme Court said exactly that view. She said, the search for doctrine in administrative law is ultimately doomed. That was her quote. I was invited to do a summary speech at the conference, and it's a paper coming out soon in the collection of essays where my focus was to disagree with her. The disagreement can go like this. I'm deploying it a different way in my paper that comes out next month. But think of the law of negligence. A doctor who makes a mistake in an operating room. Now, in the law of negligence, as most of you know, I'm sure, there's a very fine distinction that lies at the heart of negligence. A mere error of judgment versus a professional who has fallen below a standard of care. Boy, is that a fine distinction. You know, underneath your, I'm putting words in your mouth, but underneath your question is the idea that administrative law is amorphous and lines are difficult to draw. Well, listen, in the law of negligence, that's a really tough line. But after Donahue and Stevenson some 9 decades, and piles of case law, good common law method, judges kind of have the concept in mind. They kind of get it. And not only can they get it, but in some jurisdictions with civil juries, they can explain it clearly to juries. So my point is, even though the principles may seem amorphous and at present not worked out, if we're committed to the search of doctrine and respect for precedent and deducing things from precedent and engaging in distinguishing when it is warranted based on the underlying principles,
ultimately certainty increases. And I just talked about the law of negligence. There's all sorts of areas of law with crazy amorphous concepts which drive you nuts when you have to write your exams. Law is tough, but over time, the case law works it out when the judges try to do it in accordance with doctrine, not in accordance with what they think or feel or think is just.
I just wanted to get your thoughts on Doré. There's been a lot of discussion in the context of, well, obviously we've been talking sort of opaquely around this topic, but it's been one of the sort of central points of discussion about of speculation about what's going to happen after the Trinity Western appeal, and sort of roundly criticized. And I just wondered if you had any thoughts about that issue.
Right.
About
Trinity Western is under reserve, and of course I'm not going to talk about that. That's in the hands of the Supreme Court. Yeah. Doré, as some of you know, is the unanimous decision of Justice Abella on the Supreme Court, where she deals with the charter and administrative law. Suppose you have a tribunal, and it's making a decision, but its decision in some way implicates charter values, charter concepts. How is the tribunal to deal with them? In my paper on the Social Science Research Network, this one on plea for doctrinal coherence and consistency, I launch into a detailed attack of what the Supreme Court has done on Doré. The attack, I'll leave that for you to read on your own time if you're interested. It's at ssrn.com. But the fundamental objection is lack of respect for parliamentary supremacy, because not all tribunals have charter jurisdiction. Sometimes tribunals only have the powers that are given to them by statute. They don't have inherent jurisdiction like some courts. And so if a tribunal is given statutory limits, it doesn't have room to reach for some amorphous principle and import it in. They don't have the power to do that. Rather, the onus is on the litigant to challenge the statute and say, hey, it violates the charter. So I criticize the decision on the basis that it's injecting vague notions of charter values, ultimately loose definitions of those values, into all aspects of tribunal decision making, and not all tribunals are even equipped to do it. Now, cutting this very long story short, in the next month, I have another document on SSRN. It's kind of a textbook on administrative law written up in PowerPoint form. And if you go to SSRN and punch up my name, it will come up. In the next month, I'm updating it and adding a chapter on charter and administrative law. And I was telling Professor Walters this just before class, or just before this, I've come up with a decision tree based on how I think it should tumble down, starting with the principle of parliamentary supremacy and the principle that tribunals are bound by statute, absent constitutional objection to the statute. How that all tumbles down in particular cases can be reduced to a decision tree if you're loyal to the constitutional principle of parliamentary supremacy. So watch for that. It should be posted in the next month. In that document. I update that document from time to time.
My question is, imagine, say, one day you're both on the Supreme Court, and and let's say you have...
Justice Blatter's might.
But hypothetically, and you have the power to actually implement what you're suggesting here for doctrinal coherence, but the price wouldn't be going against what you're saying. You are reforming the law. So would you say you're not at that moment tempted to go against what you're arguing here in order to bring back legal doctrine?
We'd have to say it was all on principle. We're not going to set principle. But your point is well taken.
Yeah. I'm hopeful, and it won't require my presence in the Supreme Court to make it happen. As a matter of fact, I'm more effective on the court where I am. Even if someone considered me qualified for the Supreme Court, I wouldn't take it. I am hopeful that logic and reason will win out. That this looser idea that judges have immense flexibility even to rewrite statutes or ignore statutory law
I think truth will win out. That's my optimism. And I think discussions like this, people like Justice Nadella and I, who write and speak on these issues, and there's others across the country, I think I'm beginning to see a bit of a retrenchment back to a position that would make us happy. And so I'm hopeful that the law will evolve into a more satisfactory state. That's why I wrote my paper, in fact, to try and push that toboggan downhill. And I'm kind of pleased with the progress. Look, sooner or later, it has to play out, I think, in the right way, if courts are to survive. If courts are going to be respected, they have to rely more on more than just black gowns and serious faces in court. They have to rely on centuries of doctrine or decades of doctrine that have been worked out. That's our ultimate strength. Now, it doesn't matter whether it's David William Stratus, age 57, born in Scarborough, Ontario, who thinks X. That has no moral authority. What has moral authority is decades of jurisprudence that I carefully worked out. I ascertain the relevant principle and then apply it neutrally to the facts as found. That's the power of the judiciary. Not open line radio, have your say. It's founded on principles that are larger than any of us. And I think ultimately truth will win out.
One last question.
Well, I think we're out of time, actually, so I wasn't going to ask a question at all. So I have many that I would love to ask, but I wanted to thank you. And you just said something, Justice Stratus, you said other judges write and you speak. But I must say that in my experience, it's not true. It's very, very few members of the judiciary who take the time to come and speak with students so honestly and so persuasively and to write in the way that you both do. And I am enormously grateful as a student and as a teacher and as a jurist, and I wanted to thank you and ask the students here today to thank you as well.